This is the Wallis Annenberg Wildlife Crossing, under construction over the 101 just outside Los Angeles, California. When it's finished in a few years, it will be the largest wildlife crossing on the planet. The bridge is 210 feet or 64 meters long and 174 feet or 53 meters wide, roughly the same breadth as the 10-lane superhighway it crosses. Needless to say, a crossing like this isn't cheap. The project is estimated to cost about $92 million. It's a major infrastructure project on par with similar investments in highway work. And it's not the only example. The Federal Highway Administration recently set aside $350 million federal dollars to fund projects like this. The reasons we're willing to invest so much into wildlife crossings aren't as obvious as you might think, and there are some really interesting technical challenges when you're designing infrastructure for animals. I'm Grady, and this is Practical Engineering. Roads fundamentally change the environments they cross through, and while on its face it might seem that is always a disaster for wildlife, there are actually some winners amongst the losers. For vultures, crows, coyotes, raccoons, insects, and other decomposers, roads provide a buffet for nature scavengers. And they sometimes make for pretty good housing too, at least if you're a swallow or a bat. In fact, cliff swallows are now so famous for nesting on the underside of highway overpasses that they're often referred to as bridge swallows. The sides of highways have clear zones kept free from trees and similar obstacles for vehicle safety, but the lack of shade allows tender greens to thrive, creating a salad bar for species from monarch butterfly caterpillars to white-tailed deer. Of course, especially in the case of deer, this can attract animals into spending time eating dinner in danger. And the truth is that roads mostly range from a mild inconvenience to totally catastrophic for wildlife. In the battle between the two, wildlife usually loses, and in more ways than just getting squished. The ecological impacts of roads extend beyond the guardrails. Habitat loss and fragmentation, noise pollution, runoff, and of course, injecting humans into otherwise wild places are all elements of the environmental challenges caused by roads. It's actually a pretty complicated subject, and there are even road ecologists whose entire careers are dedicated to the problem. And it's not just wildlife that's affected. According to the Federal Highway Administration, there are over 1 million wildlife vehicle collisions annually on U.S. roadways. That results in tens of thousands of injuries, about 200 human fatalities, and over $8 billion of damages per year. Even if you haven't personally been involved in a collision like this, there's a good chance you know somebody who has. Along with the astronomical numbers reported by the FHA, it's likely that a huge portion of wildlife collisions go unreported. There are just a lot of cases that don't get counted, like if an animal is too small to notice, or if it survives the impact and escapes, or is collected by somebody practicing the dubious art of roadkill cuisine. Yes, it's a real thing, and there are multiple cookbooks out there for it. There's a wide range of consequences from animal collisions, from minor vehicle damage to human fatalities. When you average them out, researchers estimate that in 2021, the average cost of hitting a deer was $9,100. Of course, the bigger the animal, the bigger the economic loss. For a moose, that number is over $40,000 per collision. Regardless of how you might feel about environmental issues and wildlife, the economic impacts alone can justify the sometimes enormous costs required to let them safely cross our roadways. Luckily, for the animal and human populations alike, there's been increasing interest in reducing the negative impacts roads have on wildlife over the past few decades. I'm no stranger to infrastructure built for animals. It is fairly unusual for fish to get hit by cars, but they have their own man-made barriers to overcome. And I released a series of videos on fish passage facilities for dams you can check out after this if you want to learn more. Like aquatic species, there is a lot of engineering involved in getting terrestrial animals across a barrier. But fortunately, a lot of that research and guidance has been summarized in a detailed manual. I may not be a road ecologist, but I am an engineer, and I love a good Federal Highway Administration handbook. One of the most important decisions about building a wildlife crossing is where to put one. You might imagine that the busiest roads are where the most collisions occur, and that's true up to a point. As the number of cars on a road increases, the percentage of wildlife crossing attempts that end in a safe critter on the other side drops, and the fraction that are killed grows. But if we keep increasing the daily traffic numbers, something unexpected happens. The number of killed animals declines. Eagle-eyed viewers may realize that so far this graph is incomplete. These percentages don't add up to 100. That's because there's a third category, repelled animals. As highway traffic increases, you reach a point where the vehicles form a kind of moving fence, and all but the most brazen bucks will turn away. Road ecologists sometimes struggle to drum up support for wildlife crossings at high traffic freeways, like the Annenberg crossing in LA, because of this effect. For some people, if they don't see actual roadkills on the shoulder, they struggle to accept the greater impact on wildlife populations. Habitat fragmentation caused by roads can be difficult for any species, but it's especially hard-hitting for migratory species who have to cross in order to survive and reproduce. For example, following the opening of I-84 in Idaho, biologists recorded the starvation of hundreds of mule deer mired in the snow, unable to cross to food sources. And it's not quite as simple as the graph makes it seem. A study by Sandra Jacobson breaks down animals into four categories of crossing style. Some animals, like frogs, are non-responders, who cross roads as if they weren't there at all. Their wild instincts compel these animals to cross without regard for their own safety, and they're often too small for most motorists to notice. Next, you have the pausers, like turtles. These creatures, when spooked on the road or elsewhere, instinctively hunker down and stay put. While the shell of a box turtle might be impenetrable to a curious coyote, it's sadly no match for a box truck. Then you've got avoiders. This group often includes the most intelligent members of the local fauna. Grizzly bears, cougars, and other carnivores often fall into this category. For them, even low-traffic, rural backroads can cause significant issues with habitat fragmentation, leading to poor genetic diversity. The small gene pool of a number of Southern Californian cougars is one of the major drivers of the construction of the Annenberg Bridge. Deer fall into the last category, speeders. As the name implies, these are fast, alert animals who, given the chance, will burst across a road to get to the other side. But even these categories have their exceptions. The poster cat of the US 101 project, a cougar called P-22, famously crossed the 10-lane highway and took up residence in the shadow of the Hollywood sign. There just is no one-size-fits-all approach for getting animals across roads. Engineers and ecologists use a wide variety of mapping, including aerial photography, land cover, topography, habitat, plus ecological field data, and even roadkill statistics to choose the most appropriate locations for new wildlife crossings. And in many cases, what works for one species may be completely ineffective for another, so most designs are made for a so-called focal species with the hope that it works well for others too. But before you have a crossing, you have to get the animals to it. In most cases, that means fences, and even that is complicated. Do the focal species have a habit of digging under fences like badgers and bears? Well, then you'll want to bury a few feet of fence to maintain its integrity. And where do they start and stop? Ideally, fences will terminate in areas that are intentionally hard to cross, so animals don't end up in a concentrated path across roadways. Sometimes boulders will be placed at the end of a wildlife fence to make it less likely that animals will choose to wander on the wrong side. But inevitably, it happens. You don't want to trap animals on the highway side of a fence, so many feature ramps or jump outs that act almost like one-way valves for animals. There are even hinged doors for moderate-sized animals that allow wayward creatures to escape through fences. Once you've got a site selected, the next big choice is over or under. It turns out that going under a road is often the easiest option. In fact, in many cases, existing bridges and viaducts can naturally create opportunities for wildlife to get across our roadways. Sometimes it's as simple as building fencing to funnel animals into existing underpasses. Another option for small animals is to use culverts as crossings. The engineering and materials for culverts are pretty well established since they're used so much for getting drainage across roadways. So it's not a big leap to do it with animals too. But it can be tricky getting them to use it. Since amphibians are pretty lousy at walking long distances, it's pretty common to have many small tunnels installed near one another with special fencing to maximize survival. In some cases, they're combined with buried collection buckets. During peak migration periods, the buckets are checked and the collected amphibians are manually transported across the road. Larger animals won't fit in a culvert or a bucket, but there are some special considerations to getting them to travel beneath a highway bridge. Many animals are hesitant about dark areas during the daytime, so it's important to get as much natural light in as possible. Lighting also affects the vegetation that grows under a bridge. More light means more natural feeling areas, which means more animals will be willing to cross under. And of course, keeping people out is important too. Disturbance from the public can really affect animals' willingness to incorporate a new, unusual route into their routine. Many crossings are designed with cover objects like logs, rocks, and brush that can help encourage a wider variety of wildlife to take advantage of the intended path. But for some species, underpasses just don't work at all. You can't force a moose to do anything, really, especially something like walking through a tunnel it doesn't trust. In certain instances, the only effective way to allow safe passage across a road is over the top. For some particular focal species, an overpass might not need to be that grand. Canopy bridges just connect trees on either side of the road so primates and other tree-living creatures can get across. In Longview, Washington, there's even a series of tiny bridges for squirrels, like the famous Nutty Narrows Bridge. Of course, the most impressive, usually the most effective, and often the most expensive wildlife crossings are designed as overpass bridges. Examples include the famous eco-ducts of the Netherlands, overpasses of the Canadian Rockies in Banff National Park, and American structures like the Wallis Annenberg Wildlife Crossing. I actually have one of these nearby. Opened in 2020, the Robert L.B. Tobin Land Bridge crosses the 6-lane Wurzbach Parkway in San Antonio, Texas. These are full-on bridges designed specifically for the use of animals. Structures like these have all the same design issues as regular bridges for humans, plus their own engineering challenges as well. They have to hold up their own weight with a significant margin of safety, be designed to weather the elements for decades, and be inspected just like other bridges. They also have to be engineered to be covered in thick layers of soil and vegetation, sometimes including trees, and be sized appropriately to accommodate focal species that might travel in huge herds or be wary of tight spaces. They have to be built to provide appropriate lines of sight for nervous crossers and often have walls that shield wildlife from the noise and light of the traffic below. One fun upside is that, at least in mountainous areas, the approaches can be a lot steeper than you might use for a vehicular bridge. An elk is pretty well suited for off-roading, after all. As for the design of the bridges themselves, they're built a lot like highway bridges, usually beam bridges or arches, just with dirt instead of concrete for the deck. While the distance across a highway is long for a wandering moose, it's not generally enough to require a structure of more heroic engineering, like cable-stayed or suspension bridges. Unlike vehicular bridges, the approaches often flare out when viewed from above, making it easier for animals to locate the bridge and for better sightlines across it. This, plus the fact that they're usually covered in native vegetation, means that wildlife overpasses are among the most striking bridges you can see. It also means that from the perspective of the wildlife crossing them, these bridges can blend into the scenery. Ideally, a herd of pronghorn wouldn't even realize they're on a bridge at all. It's hard to think of any human-made structures that have transformed the landscape more than modern roadways. They have an enormous impact on so many aspects of our lives, and it's easy to forget the impact they have on everything else that we share the landscape with. Sometimes, when it comes to mitigating the negative impacts of roads on wildlife, the best thing is just to be more careful about where or if we build a road at all. But for many of the roads we already have, and the ones we might build in the future, it just makes sense. For safety, the economic benefits, and just being good stewards of the earth, to make sure that our engineering lets animals get around as easily as we can. I really like diving into topics like wildlife crossings because of their relevance to our particular point in time. With the new federal funding and engineering guidance, I think we're going to start seeing a lot more of them in the near future. I do my best to stay up to date with what's happening with infrastructure around the world. For example, recently two undersea communication cables in the Baltic Sea were damaged, causing disruptions between European countries. It might not seem like a controversial topic until you look at how different news agencies covered the story. Some offer a neutral tone, given that the cause of the damage is still unknown. Others frame the story around who might be responsible. This is why I use today's sponsor, Ground News. Ground News aggregates major news stories and adds context to make reading the news easier and more effective. This story on the fiber optic cables was covered by more than 75 outlets. You can see how just reading a single one might not give you a comprehensive viewpoint. Every story comes with quick visual breakdowns and tags for political bias, factuality, and ownership of the sources, backed by ratings from independent news monitoring organizations. For this story, you can see that the reporting is pretty equal across the political spectrum. Half are media conglomerates, and a quarter of the outlets have been rated low or mixed factuality. They also have a feature called the blind spot that shows you stories mainly covered by one side of the political spectrum. Stuff you might totally miss if you only follow a few main sources for your news. It can be really frustrating trying to follow the news just to get the facts, especially for controversial subjects like those that involve politics, environmental issues, or ongoing conflicts where there's more motivation to get a particular narrative across. And that way, journalism has a lot of power over us, and Ground News hands some of that power back to you. If you'd like a more transparent media landscape, they're offering a huge discount right now for the holiday season at the link in the description. 50% off the Vantage subscription, which includes unlimited access to all their features. That's ground.news/practicalengineering, or just click the link in the description. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.